May it please the court. My name is Gretchen Elsner and I represent Mr. Cohen. I would like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal. In this consumer protection case, the district court erred in two ways. First, it failed to consider Mr. Cohen's advertising claims. It's black letter law in this circuit under National Broiler Council versus Voss that, quote, even if a federal bureaucrat can impose the absurd, California state law can still require truth in advertising. That's basically from, it's paraphrased with Judge O'Scanlan. The statutes in the case law require that Cohen's advertising claims proceed. The district court's second error is on the labeling. The record that you have on your desks shows that Conagra failed to follow the Poultry Products Inspection Act and the agency's regulations. Conagra has presented zero evidence that its label was submitted to the USDA, reviewed, and approved.
Please go ahead, Judge Nelson.
Well, I was very taken by how you phrased that, because that suggests that they bear the burden to show that they, I mean, don't we presume a sense of regularity unless the plaintiffs come forward with actions of deception on that? I mean, they shouldn't have to prove that they complied. You should have to prove that they didn't.
Well, the preemption here is an affirmative defense. So we didn't have to even plead.
Counsel, what facts did you plead either in your complaint or in opposition to the motion to dismiss that would suggest that your claim that even with the label and what was on it and how it looked and the fact that it had statements that would have required the approval, what facts did you provide the district court? Or can you give us now on appeal that would suggest in other than a speculative way why they didn't get this approval, other than your apparent contention of how could they possibly have gotten the approval because their claims were false, which I don't think gets you anywhere. But I'm interested in what you told the district court or even what you tell us now.
Sure. So Conagra did request judicial notice, but then we pointed out that they hadn't actually presented any judicially noticeable facts of an approved label. And I can walk you through two items here. One, on the label, they claim no preservatives, and they also make that claim.
I don't think you're answering Judge Bennett's question.
You are not.
Okay, let's go ahead and then look at the actual...
What evidence do you have that they didn't do it? What evidence do you have that they didn't go and submit this to the agency?
Well, one, we have an email from counsel, from defense counsel, that they relied on a generic approval process. And then we know from their briefing that they are admitting that the generic approval process is not appropriate for a claim that a label that, or an advertisement that is making the natural claim. So there's that. And then also when you look at their actual label that they put in front of the court, you can see that that does not follow the Poultry Products Inspection Act or the implementing regulations. So that would tend to suggest that they actually didn't.
Well, but I don't think that that's persuasive. I'm slightly interested in the email from counsel, though I honestly have never heard of that being used as evidence in a case. So I'll be interested to hear what their response is, but I just don't think you can say that, well, it violates the act and therefore they didn't comply. I mean, FDA is the determiner of that.
Or in this case, it's USDA. And here we're operating in a total vacuum where counsel has just said, well, we submitted it, but there was zero evidence in front of the district court to substantiate that affirmative defense. And we didn't have to plead around that. We didn't know they were even going to make that defense when we filed our complaint. And we weren't given leave to amend. But if we were given leave to amend, we do have information that we could then plead that would get around the affirmative defense of preemption. So right now, I think that the burden is not on the plaintiff to plead that they did not do something or that they did do something, even though we could address that. So I think one of the questions to ask the opposing counsel is, what evidence do they have that they actually did get the approval, rather than going through this sort of, is it fact, is it fiction, is it fantasy, when the district court had zero evidence that Conagra actually did get the approval that it is claiming.
Well,
that it's
counsel, that's fair, and I will ask your friend that question.
Thank you. So, So this case should go forward because of Mr. Cohen's advertising claims, because it's black letter law there that goes forward on both the no preservatives and the natural claims. The court here also erred on the labeling because of
if they did submit it, would you agree that it's preempted? I take it you still wouldn't agree.
Here, there is a very specific process in 9 CFR 412.1 and 0.2 on what they need to do. And that's actually then addressed also in the answering brief, including in the footnotes, particularly page 10 of the answering brief, footnote 10. They need to go through, if they want to make the claim natural, and if they want to make a negative claim, like no preservatives, they have admitted that they cannot go through the generic approval. They have to go through the sketch approval. And that means that they have to then apply on a form that is referenced in the regulation. It's form 7234-1.
Counsel, I want to make sure that I understand part of your advertising claim correctly. That even if we were to reject the part of your claim based on the label, there's more here than what's on the label. The label says the chicken didn't have any preservatives. The advertising read at least in the light most favorable to your client reads that the whole product had no preservatives. So even if the label part is preempted, the other part on the advertising isn't preempted. Is that your argument?
Exactly, yes. And the complaint that you have in front of you does make clear that there are advertising claims under all three counts. I can direct the court to those, but
you're looking primarily, or at least in part, at ER 213, the picture there of the advertising.
That is one example of the advertising that then goes beyond the labeling, and it is separate and distinct from any.
And this is where
you're talking
says,
about the. Just so I'm clear, it's not the picture, because the picture is the same, isn't it, as the label that may or may not have been submitted, but it's the language in the paragraph next to it, or am I misunderstanding that?
You're correct. It is the language in the paragraph next to that. And Judge Nelson, if you're having a hard time reading it, then it's also in the reply brief at 23. So, and
your position is that when it says with 100% natural white meat chicken, comma, and without preservatives, mm-hmm. artificial flavors or artificial colors, that because of the way that's phrased, without preservatives, artificial flavors or artificial colors, then references not just the chicken, but the entire product.
That's correct. Yes. So if there was any ambiguity about what is on the actual label, and we think that that is designed to mislead because they're putting 100% natural in big type, and then they're putting a picture of the product, not a picture of the chicken. But if there was any ambiguity for the consumer there, if they go to the website and try to get more information, the advertising here then confirms for them that Conagra is trying to get them to think that the entire product has no preservatives, when we know, looking at the back of the label and the fine print and what Conagra has conceded in its answering brief, that the product does have preservatives.
Counsel, would it be also your position that if it wasn't clear as a matter of law what the reasonable consumer would take the preservative reference to, whether the chicken or the whole product, and we disagreed with you about the label part, that that's still an issue that would need to go to the jury because the inferences in the light most favorable to you create a triable issue of fact as to how the reasonable consumer would view it?
Yes, that's the rule of Williams v. Gerber in this circuit. And it's, I think, pretty clear that issues like that cannot be decided on a motion to dismiss because of what the reasonable consumer test is.
So, although is the reasonable consumer test, so you don't think, I mean, that is, it's not a legal question then in your view. Reasonable consumer would be a fact question.
It's a mostly a jury question, and it's often decided with expert testimony or consumer surveys on how a consumer read a particular label, keeping in mind that somebody who's going through the grocery store and spending only a few seconds looking at something is going to see, in the case of the label that's in the answering brief, the large type 100% natural and the picture of the chicken product, not just the raw chicken meat. So I think this is an issue we'll get into with some of the experts and the consumer surveys, but it's not something that can be resolved on a motion to dismiss.
So counsel, you're under 5 minutes. I think that's what you asked for, but you're free to use more of your time now.
I'll reserve, thank you.
All right, thank you. We'll hear from counsel for the defendant.
May it please the court, Noel Barrett on behalf of Conagra Brands, Inc.
Was the label submitted to the agency?
It was. And the court did not abuse its discretion in taking judicial notice of the label.
She claims that there's an email that says that you relied on a generic approval process. Did you rely on a generic approval process?
That email is not in the record.
I understand that. I'm asking you, did you rely on a generic approval process, or did you submit it to the agency?
I believe, Your Honor, that the email says that sketch approval was requested.
I'm sorry, what? Sketch approval?
A sketch approval, yes.
And what is that exactly?
Sketch approval is the type of approval that's used when what the law calls special statements are used in labels. And when special statements are used, you have to submit to FSIS for sketch approval. And what Cohen versus Trader Joe's, which is the authority that has come out here recently, confirms for us is that when sketch approval is sought, we know that FSIS reviews the entirety of the label. So there could be a label that might have some generic statements on it and some special statements on it. What we know from...
But the label was submitted. The label as currently here was submitted. Did you put this in? I go back through it, but did you put this in your answer? And I mean, you said you submitted the label, right?
That's right. The label was submitted. The label was approved. Otherwise, these products would not be put in commerce.
So did you put a declaration to that effect in support of your motion to dismiss?
There was a request for judicial notice.
I understand that. But if you submitted it and it was approved, wouldn't that have been like a half hour of work to do a declaration of a person with knowledge or a custodian of records saying, we submitted it and it was approved and I have personal knowledge, or here are our business records kept in the ordinary course which establish this?
Well, I think that there could be a concern in that event that you would convert it to a motion for summary judgment and require a whole lot more to be done. And so that's probably one of the reasons that was for the way things were done here. And I will note that, you know, there's more than a dozen district court cases that go along these same lines. There's now three circuit court cases, including one in our circuit here, that confirm what we're talking about here, that it's appropriate that when the plaintiff who brings the case puts the label into the record, the court can take judicial notice of it.
We can take judicial notice of the label, but that's different from taking judicial notice that the label was submitted to the agency.
Well, the label wouldn't be used if it wasn't submitted to the agency and approved.
Well, it's more like the label can't be used if it's submitted
I thought there was some evidence that only like 10% of the labels get submitted actually.
I'm not aware of that. No,
okay. I'm probably mixing up my cases. I apologize.
That's okay. So I did want to talk a little bit more about Cohen, which is the case that has come down. The mandate is issued in that case, and it really does address an awful lot of the issues that are in this case. It confirms that there's no presumption against preemption. It confirms what I was just talking about the generic versus sketch, and that when you have special statements on a label like we do here, under the law, the FSIS reviewed and approved the entire label. The court confirmed this procedure for taking judicial notice of labels, and it had some excellent discussion, particularly in footnote 3, of there are a lot of facts that are established as a matter of law indisputable once that label is in the record. And that's what we've been talking about now. That's another thing that's so important about the Cohen case. I'm sorry, the web case. Sorry.
Yeah. Hey, can I ask you about the website? There's no you claim you submitted the label for the packaging, but you did not submit, or at least you've never contended that you submitted the website statement to
that's right approval. That's right.
Would you agree that that constitutes labeling under the under the regulatory definitions?
That the statements on the website constitute labeling? We do believe that that is true.
On the right side? I mean, not the left side, at least at the one I'm looking at that's reproduced
here. Not the photo of the package, but the paragraph write-up at ER 213.
If you do contend that's part of the label, why?
If I understand what you're referring to, no, that is not part of the label.
So then why wouldn't the plaintiff get to proceed on that claim? The way I read this, the most natural reading, but certainly not, in my view, an unreasonable reading, is the chicken is 100% natural and the product is without preservatives. Why am I wrong?
Just to be clear, Your Honor, we are talking about the advertising claims now. Is that right?
Yes, okay, that's correct. Yes, absolutely.
Well, I think the first thing I would like to bring out here is that the argument that you just referred to is made for the first time on page 23 of the reply brief. The first time that we saw any argument involving rules of grammar or even an effort to show either the judge below or this court the specifics of what their claim here is with respect to the advertising is at the very end of the reply brief. The complaint did not go into anywhere near this detail in what they were contending. Instead, the complaint categorized the representations as four representations, all of which are indisputably on the label. And then when you look at page one of the brief in this court from the appellant, once again, they characterized all of the claims as just these four representations on the label. So I wanted to just make that point that there's a very strong waiver argument here that we're finally getting grammar arguments in the reply brief.
Well, but did they allege in the complaint? I thought they alleged in the complaint that the website was false and misleading.
They did, but in very vague terms.
So you're saying it wasn't. It didn't give you notice that they were referencing the language on the right as opposed to the picture of the package.
That's right. It didn't give any detail. It didn't make an argument about why these were allegedly misleading or anything like that. They just asked, I suppose, the district judge to look for himself. And that's just not. I don't know.
I'm looking at page one of their opening brief where it says Conagra's representations are false. The chicken products contain the SAPP, the sodium triple phosphate, the modified cornstarch, in direct contradiction to the representations in Conagra's marketing.
My point, Your Honor,
concern is there's no attempt to make, and I can understand why there isn't, but there's no attempt to make a distinction between the chicken and what Conagra breaded the chicken with. And that's where the issue is. I don't think it's with the chicken.
Well, I think that we can also look at this from the plausibility standard as well, Your Honor. I think that one of the elements of this claim is reliance by the plaintiff on the alleged misrepresentations. And I think it's important to note that.
But this is a motion to dismiss, right?
Well, it would be subject to Rule 9B, though, to a heightened standard.
I
mean, if
here's the problem you have, counsel. It seems.
I'm sorry, Judge Nelson.
No, go ahead, Judge Ezra.
If the label had said the chicken used in making this product is 100% natural, I think you'd have a better argument.
Well, I think that
honestly, what happened, in my view, is you had some good lawyers who got the label approved, and then you had some marketers who took a little bit of liberty on the website, and the lawyers weren't watching the marketers, and now you're in a little bit of a pickle.
Well, if I could go back to my point about reasonable reliance, Judge, too, because I do think it's worthy of some consideration when you realize that the plaintiff alleges in the complaint that he
does not allege in the complaint that they looked at the website, or does?
He does, but he didn't look at the website until 2018, 3 years after he had been buying the chicken. And so there's a strong argument here.
So your point is it's not material because he, well, no, but that can't be because the website goes further.
But he had already been purchasing the chicken for 3 years before he.
Well, that's because he didn't think that he thought the chicken. Okay. I hear you. I got your argument.
And there's also an argument here that that this does count as part of the labeling, and I think that there's an amicus brief that was submitted in support of our side.
Well, but the problem is, you think that the right hand, see, that's what I was getting at. You think the right hand language does constitute labeling? You're saying.
Well, I think it constitutes part of it. If you go down that line at the amicus brief, it could conceivably. I think that there's an argument.
Well, but see, my problem with that is it does differ from the package. The message is different. And you didn't submit the website. So if we're going to give you preemption for submitting the website, you get the benefit of that. But we can't give you preemption for differing labeling that doesn't cover it. Otherwise, marketers would have a heyday,
I take your Honor's point. I mean, I think that it's a closer call as to whether there's the difference in meaning with this language, but I take your Honor's point. Well, if there are no further questions, I thank you for your attention.
My colleagues have no further questions.
Thank you, Judge Bennett.
Thank you. Ms. Elsner?
Yes. So I think that we're getting more clear on the advertising and how there is no claim to preemption there and that it is different than what's on the label and that Mr. Cohen did see it before he made his final purchases of this product. And he did view that just like many other consumers have viewed it. And the meat industry amici brief here makes the point of how many more people.
Let me ask you, if he viewed it, so let's go down that line. He views, he buys the packaging and he thinks there's, well, I see. He always thought there was no preservatives. Why after he viewed the website, though, if he had a different interpretation? You're saying he didn't have a different interpretation of the website than the label.
He was misled by both.
Yeah,
yes.
I see. Okay.
So what I'd like to focus on with the court is if Conagra actually submitted the sketch approval, where is it? They did twice ask the district court for judicial notice. So they put a lot of documents in front of the court. They never put any document that shows that they submitted anything to the USDA, that the USDA reviewed any of these claims, and that the USDA approved any of the claims on the label. If they had, it seems like they would have submitted that with the request for judicial notice, but it's just not there. There is zero.
Now, counsel, I should know the answer to this question, and I apologize for not. Did you ever get to discovery in this case?
No.
We
filed one complaint. We did not get a hearing, and we were dismissed without leave to amend, which is a clear error here because the amendment is not futile. We could fix all sorts of things that are in response to what Conagra has been arguing here today, including the preemption and the affirmative defense of that. We can then allege in good faith and not with full support that they did not get the type of approval that they admit is required here. And we know that because defense counsel told us that. One of the things that they have tried to argue to the court here is in the request for judicial notice that is in the excerpts of record, they put the whole label in front of the court and they're making the argument. And this is on page, it's kind of summarized on page 45. Of the answering brief where they're looking at that package and they're zooming in on the inspected for wholesomeness and then trying to tell the court that inspected for wholesomeness applies to the label. It does not. Inspected for wholesomeness applies to the chicken product. You don't need to inspect the label for wholesomeness because nobody eats the label. That is not proof that the label was approved. And what we have here in front of us, what the court has in front of it, shows that this label could not have been approved. Not only was it not submitted, not reviewed, and not approved, but it could not have been because they make the claims that there are no preservatives, but you can see right on from the, if you turn it over and you have a magnifying glass, there are preservatives in that product. So that is false.
Could you submit a FOIA request and get their? Could you submit a FOIA request and determine whether they submitted it? Isn't that something the plaintiff could do?
Possibly. Those FOIA requests take a very long time to fulfill, and you don't necessarily get them. I also know from other groups that have made these FOIA requests that they often hear back from the USDA that no records exist to support that. However, Conagra does have the duty to keep that label. And
So counsel, part of your argument, which you claim is non-speculative, is there are things here that couldn't have been approved, not because they're false, but because it has words on them that the agency just simply wouldn't have approved, and that's at least some evidence that should put the onus on them who would have the record to just put it in if they got it.
Close. Part of our argument here is that because they say no preservatives, but there clearly are preservatives, that violates the PPIA's misbranding requirements. And that's in 453H. It defines what misbranding is. It's false or misleading. It's patently false that this is preservative free or no preservatives when you turn it over. And you can also then check the website to see that it is a product that has a lot of preservatives. Same with the natural claim. The natural claim, they're not allowed to use if they're putting it on a processed product. And here, it is a processed product, and it has preservatives in it, and so it would not qualify for natural either. If there was any meaningful review at USDA of this, then that should have been flagged, and that label never would have been approved.
All right. Thank you. We thank both counsel for their helpful arguments, and the case just argued is submitted.